Amen. Good morning again, church. Good to see you. Woke up this morning. Your mind was on Jesus. You said it's Sunday morning. It's time to go to church.
Amen.
Some of you said with King David, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Some of you with the Apostle Peter up there on that mountain with Jesus and Moses, Elijah appeared unto him. And Peter said, Lord, it's good for us to be here.
Mm-hmm.
Some of you are with the Apostle John out there on that mountain, out on that island called Patmos. He said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day.
Right.
And I know you are here this morning to worship God in spirit and in truth.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not up here this morning to try to entertain you, but I am up here to inspire you through the word of God.
Amen.
If you want entertainment, wait until Saturday, the Final Four. You have all the excitement and entertainment you need.
That's right.
So if you are here for any other reason besides giving worship to God, then you are in the wrong place.
Amen.
Our minister, Brother Gino, will be back next Lord's Day, so let us pray for their safe return as they travel back
Amen.
Over the highways. So this morning, I want to speak to you on things that happened there in Daniel chapter 5. And my lesson subject will be taken from verse 27. Where God said, weigh in the balance and count want. Now I know we have heard many, many sermons and lessons on this particular subject. But the Bible is a book in such a way that no matter how many times you read it or you hear something taught from it, you can always get something else.
Right.
You can always get a point. So today I want to go back to ancient Babylon and look upon a royal banquet. The banquet was given by Belshazzar, the young king. And you know, young folks, they can do some foolish things.
That's right.
They can act foolish sometimes. Somebody say, oh, folks too. Well, the palace here, it was lit up with lights. They had long tables. They were set up for thousands of guests.
That's right.
And you see, I want you to see this with your mind's eye, how that the lights, how they were twinkling off of the silver and gold dishes. Young folks, they know how to give a party, don't they? The most important people was at this table. They had on their rich garments, their fingers and their arms, they had on all types of precious jewelry, and their air was heavy with perfume. Heavy with music. Parties today, I would say, not only heavy with perfume and heavy with music, but also filled with marijuana smoke. Picture the half-clothed dancers as they were moving in and out, doing their enticing dance, entertaining the guests here. Laughter and jokes were flying back and forth. Getting the picture? The king and his guests, they were getting drunker and louder every hour. And the king rejoiced that was able to put on such a great, grand party here, where the folks would have such a good time. And as the hour passed, the party became a little dull. Just like parties today, goes along good. And then it get a little dull, and when it get a Pretty soon the police are called. Well, this party had gotten a little dull here. And the Bible said that the king decided to do a daring thing. He called one of his stewards to him, and he whispered a command into his steward's ear, and the steward left the room. And the guests, they began to wonder what was going to happen next. Young folks, you go to these parties, it might start out a good. And then someone would maybe slip a little liquor in the punch. Somebody might slip out to go and get something or pull something out of their party, and then the party goes bad. And so the Bible said that the steward, he returned and he brought with him the cups of gold and silver that his grandfather had carried away from the temple of Jehovah in the city of Jerusalem. And can you just hear them saying, fill it up, drink, be merry. And so they filled up the cups of the Lord. Yeah. And it was not, I'm not talking about communion here either. No. And they drank to the king and these false gods. And their laugh became even more louder. Listen, can you almost hear them cry out, who is this God of the Jews? Where is he now? We are the master race. Have another drink from the sacred cup of the temple. Hearty, har, har. My big mama would say, boy, you're getting too big for your britches. But notice, suddenly, the Bible said a hush fell on them like death. Suddenly, the banquet hall, it got quiet. One fella said, look over there, look over there. Look at that hand writing on the wall. A hand without an arm on it. A hand without a body attached to it. Party's over. And this hand was writing in large letters upon the wall. Then the king turned and he looked, and all at once he became pale. He began to shake. His knees began to knock together. He wondered what all this is all about. Nothing like this had ever happened before. You know, sometimes I wish God would work that way today, shake up some people. But wait a minute, maybe he already is, and we are not aware of it. We don't realize that God is working to shake folks up today. Especially America, who says in God we trust, but they're taking God out of everything. And so he sent for his wise men, his soothsayers. If they were so wise, I believe they would have advised him, don't do that. Don't go and get those cups from the Lord's, belongs in the Lord's house, giving him some wise advice there. Amen. But the Bible said that they came marching in, ready to give some new favors from the king, huh? And but when they saw the hand writing on the wall, they were also confused. And that confidence that they had on their face, it began to fade away. They could not give an answer, the meaning to what was being written on that wall. Bethsaida was more shaken up than he ever was. He did not know what to do next. Then the Bible mother came in. His mother-in-law. And let me put this here for us men. Sometimes we need to listen to our mother-in-laws. She has some good advice here. She had heard about all this confusion that was going on, and she said to the king, "Don't worry, there is one in the kingdom wiser than all others. His name is Daniel. He can interpret the writing and give you an answer to this." And so the Bible said that King David, he sent for Daniel, and when Daniel came in, the king began to flatter him, saying, "I have heard that you are great and you are a wise man. And if you tell me what is written here, I will give you many rich gifts and make you third ruler in my kingdom." And then God's man said, "I don't want any of your gifts. Give them to someone else, but I will tell you the meaning of the writing. First, I must tell you why it came." As if he didn't know what he was doing when it happened. You know, he told him, "You know how your grandfather, Nebuchadnezzar, he was blessed by God. He done an awful thing, but he was blessed by God. Then you know how he turned away from God and finally he humbled himself and he came back to God. Let him know that your father, he changed, but you lifted yourself up against God. You have not glorified him. You even had the nerves to take the vessel out of God's house, use them, drink wine from them while you praise your God of wood and stone. And the reason why these things are written on the wall is because of what you had done. While I'm passing by here, let me drop this in. Now, the temple and all the things that were in the temple were to be respected and taken care of. Am I right about it? All right, I'm going to have the janitor here now. We all are in the house of the Lord. This is the house of the Lord, right? And the things that are in the house of the Lord, we should respect and take care of, right? Those pews that you're sitting in, the chairs, the table, the floors are in the house of the Lord. And I believe that we should respect and take care of those things. Because if you don't take care of the Lord's house and what's in the Lord's house, whose house will you respect? Shonda said, "Thank you, Brother Cooper." All right. All right. Now Daniel said, here is what the writing means. God said, "You are through." And you know, when God said you are through, brother, you are through. Your time is up. You are finished. You have been weighed in the balance and you have found wanting. Weighed in God's scale and found wanting. You know, back then, a scale, they had two pans. And then it had something in between those pans. That was called the balance. And when you wanted to weigh something, you would put it in this pan and on one side. And in the other pan, you begin to add weight until it levels off. And then you know just how much that thing weighed. Now let me talk about a scale, our scale. You know that little thing that lying scale, huh?
Right.
That can't be right. I know I don't weigh that much, but the scale do not lie. It just say, oops, there it is. We don't want to worry about the scale. Now, if you were weighed in God's scale, you don't want to be found underweight.
Right.
Needing more meat on your, I'm talking about your spiritual body now.
Right.
You want to have on the whole armor of God. You want to be well. Overweight is okay here. But when you get on the scale at home, you can go along with a little underweight. But when you step on God's scale, in the judgment, you do not want to be underweight. You can be overweight on your scale at home. You don't want to be found wanting at the day of judgment. You want to be at the right weight. But if you are overweight, I'm talking about overweight with sin. What does Hebrews 12 and 1 say? It says, let us lay aside every weight the sin that does so easily beset us. So we need to lay aside that way of sin, and we're going to step on God's scale.
Amen.
So if you don't study God's word, and you never know what you need,
right,
in order to be saved, to keep the weight of sin off of you. Now, some folks, they don't like scales. Some folks, they just look at it and walk away. Some say, I would not have one in my house. But that do not change a thing about the scale. The scale is telling you the truth. Can you handle the truth? You know, I stepped on a scale once, and I know where I wanted it to stop. And the scale got to that number and just kept on going. Stop, stop, stop. Didn't listen to me, just kept on going. Don't get mad at the scale. Don't get angry with the scale. Talking back at the scale. You can't be right. But say, thank you, scale, for telling me the truth. Then the scale will say, no, thank you for getting off of me. Now, that's enough about the scale. I think you got the picture. Don't get mad at God's word when it's telling you the truth. Just accept God's word and obey God's word. And so the Bible said the Belshazzar, he was weighed in the balance and he was found a woman. Now your kingdom will be divided and given to the Mede and the Persian. And this was bad news for Belshazzar, but he kept his promise that he made to Daniel. He gave him third ruler in the kingdom. And so Belshazzar was killed, letting us know that you cannot joke with God, because God is no joke. And the joke will be on us at the judgment. Now, the Bible said that Belshazzar was not weighed in the scale of public opinion. Because, you know, people would have said, well, he's a great statesman. He put on a great party. He is one of our five young men. So he was not weighed in the scale of public opinion, what people thought of him. Because what people thought of him, God might think the opposite. He was not weighed in the scale of his own estimate of himself, because he thought himself to be a mighty fine fellow. but rotten. You do not have anything in you that's good. Some folks are ranked high, and you may think that you are a heavyweight, but you do not weigh an ounce on God's scale, because they have never seen the need of God. Jesus is a forgotten man in their life. God's balance was found in the Bible. It was found in God's commandments. Now, the only scale that they had back then during Belshazzar's time was the Old Testament, the old law. They was under the Mosaic law. They did not have the New Testament then. So on Judgment Day, they will be judged and put in that scale. And then those who lived and died under the patriarch age will be judged by that patriarch scale and judgment. And we who live under the New Testament, the New Covenant, we will be weighed in that scale. So I'm saying here that we have three scales used in the Judgment Day. And they all is right because they all are the Word of God. Now, the Ten Commandments, these Ten Commandments that God gave the children of Israel, all but one of those commandments has been brought over into the New Testament. And that one that was not brought over is the one that says, keep, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. But all those other commandments, you can read about them in the Bible, the Word of God. So how does your life measure up as you compare it to God's law? So let's go back to these commandments. Number one, it says, thou shalt have no other God before me. What is man's God? What is your God? What's my God? It's the thing that we think the most of. Some people worship money. Money is their God. They will do anything. They will cut any corners in order to get a money in their pocket. Some people make social standing their God. They would rather have their names in the newspaper than their names on the Lamb's Book of Life in heaven. Some people worship the God of pleasure. Now, it's all right to have a good time, but we are not to be a slave to worldly pleasures. Where are the great crowds on Sunday night? I tell you where they're not. Show up here 5:30. They are not in the house of God, but some, they're out looking for pleasure. Some look at TV, stay at home, and that's their God instead of worshiping God. Jesus said the first of all the commandments is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Have no other God before me. Don't put anything before your God and your worship to God. Number two, it says, thou shalt not make any image of God and worship them. Now, I know we have so-called pictures of Jesus on the wall, and maybe even have a little statue of Jesus, but the sin come in when we bow ourselves before these objects and we worship them, then that is a sin. And how can they do this when they read, thou shalt not have any other God before me? There was a man one time, he was cleaning out shed or something, or this lady, and came across an old picture of Jesus all dirty and wrinkled and tore. And he was getting ready to throw that picture away, and she shouted, "Stop! Don't throw Jesus in the garbage." That's not. Should be our idol. Number three, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord in vain. Now that's a good commandment. In the Old Testament or in the New Testament, that's a good commandment here. Just like some folks, they set up, fill the air with their devil-pleasing, God-defying profanity. Mm-hmm. And they think nothing of it. You put cursing profanity in a book, a novel, and you have a bestseller. Rappers, if they put profanity, cursing in their CD, they have a hit. Words that were banned on TV now are flowing everywhere. Folks think nothing of it. Used to, you hear a word and it'll make your skin crawl within you, but now it's just another thing. We hear people that every other word, you see, every other word is a curse word. Have you been around folks like that? Every other word out of their mouth is a curse word. You hate to be around a person like that. One man said, when I became a Christian, I became saved, I lost half of my words, half of my vocabulary. And that was a good thing. Some folks need to get their mouths out of the gutter.
Amen.
And learn to use clean speech at all times and not just around your church members.
Amen.
Some folks get back away from around us and you just stand around the corner. Hey, that brother, sister, so much soul.
Holy.
Loud and clear. But in the church service, song service, can't hear it. So we need to clean up our speech. You know, some folks say, well, oops, that slipped out. How did that happen? If those words are not on the back of your tongue, they won't slip out of your mouth.
Amen.
What are they doing in there anyway?
Amen.
Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Those words won't slip out. No oops. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the mouth, of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So let Jesus fill your heart, and the right thing will come out of your mouth.
Amen.
I just hate even standing by a person that's cursing and carrying on, and I take a step waiting on the lightning to strike. So we should watch our speech. Don't let our speech deceive us.
Amen.
That's one of the evidence that you are a child of God. Then number four, it says, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. People often ask why we don't observe Saturday, the Lord, the Sabbath day, instead of doing it on the first day of the week and not on the Sabbath day, like they did in the Old Testament. Well, the Bible said what God created the world, he finished his work in 6 days, and the Bible said then he rested on the seventh day. Is that right?
That's right.
Now, here is God. Now, was God really tired?
No.
That he had to rest? No. he saying here? His work was finished. He finished the creation,
right,
and then he just commemorated a finished creation, resting on the seventh day. But we live in a new dispensation, you see. We do not observe the Sabbath day, but the Lord's day. That is the day that's called in the New Testament the Lord's day. On the first day of the week, Jesus rose from the dead. The church came in existence on the first day of the week. So in order to commemorate something that is most important, it is more important than a finished creation. But this thing that's been in God's mind, and that is a finished redemption. That is more important than a finished creation. And that's why we worship him, not on the seventh day, but on the first day of the week.
Amen.
That's when we are commanded to worship God. Now on Sunday, we remember Jesus rose from the dead. You get up, you put on your Sunday best, get ready for Sunday school with your Bible in your hand, and you start out towards the church. What are you doing? You are remembering that you are going to worship the one who loves you, died for you, rose again on the first day of the week. But some say they stay out late on Saturday night and then like to stay in bed until 11 or 12. Now church is going on now, Sunday school, church, on Sunday morning. Then they sit around the house all day. Sunday evening come, I should go to church tonight, but I'm not. They are breaking this commandment. Not remembering the Sabbath, but remembering, not remembering the Lord's day. The day that we should come forth, worship God in spirit and in truth, presenting our bodies to him as a living sacrifice, holy, without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. The Lord's day. In closing, I could go on, but I'm going to stop here. This is part one. Come back this evening and we will take on part two. Get back on the scale and finish this weigh-in.
Right.
Don't stay at home now. Come on back. Now, if God's plan of salvation is on one side of the scale, you on the other, how will you weigh in? Have you obeyed God's plan? Have you obeyed the gospel of Christ? Have you heard God's word and then believe what you've heard, that God is the Son of God? And have you repented of your past sin? Then make that honorable confession before men that you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Then be buried in the watery grave of baptism, rise to walk in newness of life, where you are added to the church. If you haven't made that step, then you're going to be found wanting. And if you need prayer, you need strength, then you should also come. This is weigh-in time, y'all. Don't be afraid. Get on the scale. You found wanting, then you know what to do to get right. So the the two brothers that are going to come up. And as they come, then we ask you, if you have a prayer request, you come up to these brothers. And the song leaders right now, they're going to start singing.
All of my trials, my trials, and all.